Hello, I'm Joan Kjaer, and this is World Canvass. Thank you for being with us tonight for our program, Taping the World. World Canvass is presented by International Programs, your global intersection, connecting Iowa with the world in a university without borders. It's a great pleasure to have you here with us this afternoon in the Old Capitol building in the Senate chamber. This program will be broadcast over UITV and KRUI, and we're streaming the program live over International Programs' website, accents.international.uiowa.edu. Tonight's World Canvass will focus on the tape recorder and the changes this little piece of technology has brought to all sorts of human interactions, whether they be social, political, cultural, familial, or artistic. Here to help us wrap our heads around this topic are two professors from the Department of Communication Studies in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences here at the University of Iowa, John Durham Peters and Kembrew McLeod. Please give them a warm welcome. Well, so let me introduce you first, John. John Peters, and you are, I think, chairing your department now.
Yes.
I have that distinct pleasure, yes. I say with great irony.
Yeah. And your life is absorbed with thoughts about communication, how we deal with one another, what communication means, sort of big issues related to communication. And now you and Kembrew are involved in this project, Taping the World, is what you've called a series of lectures, and I think you may be intending kind of a long investigation related to this.
Yeah.
So tell us about where you're going with this.
Well, I'm really interested in how small devices have big meanings. And the tape recorder might seem like something really inconsequential in terms of the larger scheme of things, but I'm really interested in devices that allow us to cheat death. Because, I mean, one of the fates of us human beings is that, sadly, we're all going to die. And time is this thing which just keeps flowing away, and we can't control it. But with the tape recorder, you can do this amazing thing called time axis manipulation. You can play things backwards, play them faster. You can take a razor blade and cut it. And I'm just really interested in the ways that, you know, that we can deal with the most fundamental problem of our mortality with this little thing with a couple spools and some circuits and some magnetism.
Yeah. Well, and you and Kembrew put together a wonderful opinion piece that was in the Press Citizen yesterday, where you talked about some of the not only historical archival material that lives on tape, but family moments, things that would otherwise be lost forever, and in many cases are being lost forever because people no longer have a tape recorder that can play any of this stuff back.
Right. Well, so much of who we are depends on our memory, and so much of our memory depends on our media. And I sometimes wonder what would happen if all the scribbles that I've done in paper went up in smoke, or the wonderful mixtapes that my wife sent to me of wonderful music interspersed with radio commentary were to disappear. And they sort of have disappeared because I know where they are, but I don't know really how to play them anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, I could.
Yeah.
But it's actually sort of more interesting to worry about the loss of something so consequential.
Mm-hmm.
Because as lots of people have pointed out, one of the great things we need to worry about in our age is losing loss. I mean, in this age of Google and indexing and cataloging and tagging, we've seen that you can't lose anything.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's fun to think about stuff that disappears and sort of, you know, this graveyard of recorded sound and meaning and memory and life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, and there's been such a change in the way people communicate with loved ones and family members. So much of it is email these days, and although it may live somewhere out there on a hard drive in space, you don't have that little letter any longer that lives in a treasure chest.
You know what? One of my students told me that email's for old people.
Oh.
And I said, what do you mean old people? And they said, well, people over 25. And young people use texting.
I see.
Okay. But the point holds because,
yeah.
I mean, how do you archive your text?
Mm-hmm.
At least emails
mm-hmm.
get archived,
mm-hmm.
or they can get archived, unless you're Bill Gates and figure out a way to wipe out a whole bunch of strategic emails.
Right.
Richard Nixon did this with the 18 minutes of tape.
Right.
And so we have a silence there which stands for the fall of a president. These media interact with who we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I love the story of Friedrich Nietzsche, the great German philosopher, who was hard of hearing. He was one of the first people to write on a typewriter. And he was typing, one of the first things he typed was, this machine is working with me on my thoughts. Because he thought differently when he was writing on a typewriter.
Mm-hmm. Do you think differently and write differently when you...
We're radically embodied beings, and media are extensions of our bodies. And when we write, when we speak, when we talk, when we record ourselves, we're different in interestingly subtle ways, but profound ways, I think. Mm-hmm.
Well, Kembrew, let's go to you for a second. Let's follow this thought just a little bit further. Are you different? Do you process things differently or put them down differently, whether you're, using a typewriter, maybe you don't use a typewriter anymore, but using a computer, using, speaking into a voice recorder. Is that all a different, there are changes in each of those processes depending upon the technology?
Yeah, and I'd like to answer that question a little differently because I've been thinking about, while working in different media, doing my research and intellectual work in different media, and what I mean by that is there are profound differences, not just legally, but in other ways as well, about what happens when I do my research on the printed page or in print on the computer, and versus when I'm basically trying to tell the same stories in an audio or audiovisual medium, because there's a profound difference because, as Elvis Costello once said, and I kind of sympathize this because I've been a music critic for a while, writing about music is like dancing about architecture, and he's getting at the difficulty in trying to store and describe sound in the print medium.
But he liked dancing about architecture.
Yeah, yeah. Well, although he did add, just because he was being snarky, it's a really incredibly stupid thing to want to do. But he later backed off that the second part. But yeah, it's different. Rather than trying to store and describe audio in a print medium, show, not just tell. And that's the wonderful thing about, the magnetic tape. It was one of the first media, and it was a medium that lasted for about 50 years, from the 50s really till the end of the 20th century. And it allowed for storage and for time shifting, and as John was saying, you can cut things up and you can rearrange and edit things. And there's just something also different about hearing the sound rather than reading the sound described. Mm-hmm. So that's what I've been thinking about a lot, especially because I recently finished a documentary about sampling and sound collage with a University of Iowa alum, an alum of our department, Communication Studies, Ben Franzen. It's actually showing on PBS's Independent Lens this Sunday if you want to tune in. But if you're watching this, it's probably too late. I based the film on a chapter from a book I wrote about sampling. But when I moved from the print medium to an audio or audiovisual medium to tell the exact same story, we are running afoul of the same copyright laws that we're trying to document the hip-hop artists who ran afoul of copyright laws. Also, the same situation. There are many, many ironies in making a documentary mm-hmm. titled Copyright Criminals. And there are many ironies in just shifting media from print to audio.
Yeah. And so in case you missed it, the name of this documentary is Copyright Criminals. Those of you who are here today will be able to watch it, if you remember, on Sunday night, 11 o'clock, Independent Lens on Iowa Public Television. And you are also a robo-professor, right?
I'm a robo-professor. That was... the Des Moines Register came up with the term robo-professor. The night that they printed the headline, it's a long story, I'm not going to get into why they called me a robo-professor, but they printed the headline, robo-professor, blah, 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 and I was like, wow, that's an amazing combination of words, and I Googled it, and there, I couldn't find it. And so they basically coined a term, and then I stole it.
And did you copyright it? Did you trademark it?
No, but it is it's a URL, roboprof.org. That's my new web hub because I have so many different URLs and websites. instead of having an email signature that's like 6 lines long. Just one line, RoboProf.
Yeah. Well, before we move into the next little segment with some music on iPhones, let's go back a little bit to sort of a big overview of what the tape recorder has really meant in terms of social life, political life, the history of the last 50, 60 years or so. Could you reflect on that, John?
Sure. Well, its origins are military. And like a lot of entertainment media, people started abusing military equipment, basically. And so right after World War II in France, Germany, United States, you have lots of composers who are discovering you can do really interesting things with this. In fact, I think I got interested in this project when I stumbled into a class 30 years ago when I was an undergrad by Vladimir Ussachevsky, one of the great pioneers of tape recorder music. And so he just got me, his argument was always that with the tape recorder we can think of music in terms of science and technology, that math was our only outer limit of music and that we had a new vocabulary of sound. I thought that was really exciting. But the tape recorders had so many different kinds of subtle impacts. I mean, you can think about listening to dead people. So, I mean, there's this whole phenomenon of studying electronic voice phenomena, which originates in Sweden and other places in the late 50s. This guy is trying to listen to bird song, and starts hearing these strange voices. And when you play the tape recorder slow or fast or backwards, that's where the voices come out.
Oh.
Yeah, so, and it's almost as if the tape recorder is the very condition that enables all these interesting, bizarre voices to come out. The same thing is being done with dolphin research in the late 1950s. Our LSD-popping friend, John Lilly, who explored dolphin research in the Virgin Islands, would once played a tape of his course of his discussion with a dolphin, in which the dolphin is talking about the tape recording. And then he plays it to the dolphin, and the dolphin starts talking about the tape recording, and he tapes this. But it's only hearable if you play it slow, because dolphins squeak so high. So I mean, there's basically all these funny frontiers of culture and of imagination. The tape recorder is thinking with us. Of course, they're political. Resonances, musical, cultural, literary. There's so many authors who've experimented with the tape recorder as a way of chunking up discourse in strange ways.
Yeah. Well, and then films. One of my favorite movies, which probably goes back, must be 25 years ago now, The Conversation.
35
years ago.
It's right after Watergate.
Yeah, right after Watergate, and maybe you can tell.
Coppola won the Academy Award for The Godfather. He can do absolutely anything he wants. He does this amazing film with sound by Walter Murch, who visited University of Iowa.
Oh, really?
Several years ago. Hmm. It's amazing as a sound artifact, but what it says about listening and surveillance and nervousness and actually getting things profoundly wrong.
Profoundly wrong. Well, anything else we want to say as an overview before we talk a little bit about copyright? You mentioned it already, Kembrew, but can you talk a little bit about how you feel about owning sound or owning words?
Yeah. I just find it really odd that, first of all, Congress is primarily composed of lawyers, but they end up writing laws based on what lobbyists say, and lobbyists tend not to think metaphysically about the differences in, well, working in different media. So, for instance, there are all these strange contradictions in the way that we treat the ownership of texts, whether we're talking about the written word or sound. And so, for instance, it's perfectly acceptable to exactly imitate a Bo Diddley drum beat and make it sound exactly like the original recording. Dun 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 da dun 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 da dun dun. But as soon as you sample that drum beat, you have a different series of statutes essentially get triggered, and you have to automatically get permission. And you don't have to get permission if you want to cover someone else's song, because all you have to do is pay 9.1 cents per copy. If you record your own version, that is, if I play a James Taylor song, I'm perfectly able to record it and release it commercially without asking James Taylor's permission, as long as I pay the statutory fee. And you know, if we're writing, if we're quoting in print another book, that's perfectly fine as long as you're not quoting like 200 pages of another book. Mm-hmm. But as soon as we try and quote more than two lines of a song, our publisher might well tell us no unless you get permission, or we could potentially get a cease and desist letter. So anyway, the idea that you can, I don't know, the rules about ownership of culture are extremely inconsistent when you're moving across media and moving across communities of practice. And I'm completely fascinated by that, and I'm still trying to work through it, which is why I'm stumbling a little bit, because it's a metaphysical question that I will probably never answer. But practically, it's because the laws that are written by industries that have the most money and power at any given time, and they get to make up the rules about how culture is owned and what sort of access we're allowed to have to quotations.
Right. Well, this does in some way, of course, go back to the original creator of that, you know, if Bo Diddley put something down and is known for that song, the artist's complaint is that, hey, people grab my stuff and I don't get any payment for that, but somebody else has made a huge hit out of it. So, I mean, it seems to me that there is some kind of argument to be made for artists being paid for their work.
But Oh, totally. I agree. I mean, what I was trying to get at is, going back to the Bo Diddley example, you could mic the room and the drum kit to make that drum sound that's in the original Bo Diddley recording, make it sound exactly the same. And there's no copyright infringement triggered then.
Right.
But if you sample it and it sounds exactly like the recreation of that drum beat, but the fact that you've accessed the original audio source, you can go to jail.
Yeah. Well, we're going to do something fun here now. We'd like to invite Loren Glass to come up to the stage. Say hello to Loren Glass, please. Loren is a professor in the English department, and he and Kembrew make up the ensemble, the Killer Apps. And I'm going to ask Kembrew to explain what the group is.
Thank you. So, first of all, we have some technical limitations. We can't run our phones through the cords because the signal's too distorted, so we're actually going to play with just the speakers into the microphone. But before I introduce us and what we're about to do, one thing that I wanted to bring up is goes back to the tape, the magnetic tape medium, is magnetic tape allowed us to, as I said and John said, store sounds and also edit sounds and kind of play sounds live. And in many ways, the magnetic tape contains many of the same characteristics that is celebrated about digital media. The fact that you can re-edit, the fact that it's transferable. So, you know, back when Marcia sent John these mixtapes, it was still portable, it just took a little bit longer to get through the mail. And so that's what I mean about, what I find interesting about magnetic tape is a lot of the same characteristics that, we find novel in digital media were already there for about 50 years. And so in the spirit of the tape, we thought we'd put together a medley of three songs that you'd likely hear on an 8-track in the 70s. So it'll be short segments, samples of ELO's Telephone Line, Blondie's Call Me, and Kraftwerk's Telephone Call.
So it might be illegal.
Actually, this is a good time to discuss whether or not it's illegal since we're taping this.
Long story, I won't get into it. But it actually should be legal, what we're doing.
Okay.
Because when this is aired over KRUI, KRUI is covered by a special blanket license that allows us to play whatever sounds, which is another kind of inconsistency that I find interesting. So we're the Killer Apps. This is Loren.
Hello.
Dr. G. I'm robo-professor. And I guess we'll just play, and then Joan can ask us about how we do the stuff we do. So here we go.
Vocals recordings, George Martin.
Cut, you can edit. Obviously, you can slow down or speed up the tape. You can put in backward stuff. You can put in electronic sounds which can possibly be produced live. You can use combinations of instruments which are completely unbalanced, but you can make the balance. You can put a, well, you can put a very soft flute against a huge brass chord and still make it sound loud. Then cut up the tape and bring it out through that in the air to settle down the ground, join them all up.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so for those of you listening to this program and not here in the room with us, you were hearing Kembrew McLeod and Loren Glass play music and various sounds with their iPhones. And Loren, let me ask you to tell us what all you were doing here. It looked like you were strumming a guitar at some point.
Yeah, well, there's innumerable apps which mimic and approximate the instruments that we have to carry around and lug around in larger format in our regular lives. Many of them mimic guitars, and this one actually, you can't see it out there, I guess, but there actually is a version of a guitar fretboard here. You can program in both chords, fret positions, scales, various effects and sounds, and really pretty accurately mimic most of what your guitar at home can do.
Except I think you can fit it in your pocket.
That's right, so you can carry it. And then the other program I was using is actually more, it's a synthesizer program called Bebot. It has a nice little graphic that you can't see. And here the whole screen is sensitive to sound. I don't have it programmed right now to play a scale, but you can actually, into this one, also program in scales and keys and chords and manufacture various sounds. So I basically, the term we've coined for me is at the abstrumentalist. I play the instruments over the sounds that Kembrew is able to mix using his more DJ-type programs, which he can tell you as well.
Yeah, I'm actually not a DJ, I'm a PJ, jockey. but yeah, and so I basically take samples, and even just in the past year, the kinds of applications or apps, hence the name, the killer apps, that exist for basically remixing stuff live, DJing, have exploded. And they're still not quite there yet, but they're far more flexible in what you can do, so. Here, let me just show you, like, for instance, or play for you something. I'm showing Joan the phone, and you can probably see from here, like, there are waveforms, basically a visual representation of the sound, so when a bass drum hits, the waveform is really wide. And so that gives you the chance to kind of visually keep track of what's going on, and it also allows you to create loops. And by a musical loop, I mean doing what people used to do with tape loops, which is cut, for instance, right on the downbeat, let it play, for 5 seconds, and then end the loop right before the next downbeat hits, so that it creates kind of a rhythmic circular sound. So here's a song that most of us are probably familiar with. It's from a Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, and it's actually the reprise, so I'll just play a little bit of it. I mean, just a few more seconds. Okay, so I'm now gonna play a recent song by Lady Gaga, Telephone. So here we go. Okay, So what you can do is basically, I just created a loop of the Beatles just so it's playing. So anyway, you can basically mix two tracks together and play them live on your phone.
On your phone. Amazing, amazing. Well, thanks, Loren. Thank you, Kembrew. We're going to talk to Kembrew and John a little bit later. Thanks for playing all this. And hey, give him a big hand, huh? So this is a program called Taping the World, and our next guests are coming up to join us now. You were just listening to John Peters, Loren Glass, and Kembrew McLeod. This is World Canvass from International Programs at the University of Iowa, connecting students, faculty, and Iowans with one another and the world. I'm Joan Kjaer. If you're interested in things international, please take the opportunity to check out our website. You'll find all sorts of interesting information about the people and projects of International Programs, original articles and commentary, and links to events with an international focus. You can find all that at accents.international.uiowa.edu. And in this next segment of World Canvass, we're going to consider the tape recorder and the artist's voice. I now have the pleasure of introducing three very special people. Chris Merrill is just next to me here, and he's a poet, journalist, and the director of the International Writing Program here at the University of Iowa. Ed Folsom is our next guest, and he's Carver Professor of American Literature at the University of Iowa and one of the world's preeminent Whitman scholars. And Garrett Stewart on the end is the James O. Friedman Professor of Letters at the University of Iowa, studies things like Victorian fiction, narrative theory, textual politics, and visuality studies. Please welcome them. In this section of the program, I wanted to talk a little bit about the voice, particularly the voice of an author, whether a poet, you know, somebody who writes prose. What do we learn from the voice when we can hear the words that are written on the page in the author's voice? What can we assume from the voice? How does the experience of the voice alter what we might have perceived from the written word? And what do the spaces between the words mean or not mean? I'd like to start with Chris Merrill. And before I ask Chris to comment, we're going to hear two readings of a work of poetry written by a Palestinian poet named Ghassan Zaktan. First, we'll hear his poem, Four Girls from Zakaria, read in English, and after that, we'll hear it read in his native language, Arabic.
Four sisters in the dark read wet letters. A train coming from Artouf passed behind the picture. A horse carrying a girl from Zakaria neighs on the ridge across the plain. In the gorge, clouds slowly pass. Four sisters from Zakaria, alone in black clothes on the hill.
أربع أخوات من زكريا. أربع أخوات. يتسلقنا الجبل وحيدات بثياب سود أربع أخوات يتنهدن أمام الحرش أربع أخوات في العتمة يقرأن بريدا مبدل كان قطار يعبر خلف الصورة من عرتوف كان حصان يحمل بنتا من زكريا يصهل في المنحدر وراء السهل وكان الغيم يمر بطيئا في الخدود أربع أخوات من زكريا عند الدل وحيدات بثياب سود.
Okay, so that was the same poet, poem read first by the author in English and after that by the author in Arabic. And this is a gentleman you know. It's someone many of us met when he was here working with the IWP writers. And I would like to ask you, Chris, I know you're a translator, you know writers from all over the world. Tell me something about the author's voice when it relates to the original language as opposed to any translation.
Well, the first thing that came to mind listening to Hassan speak, you'll notice how deep his voice is when he reads in his native language, in Arabic. And I remembered a lecture that the American poet Galway Kinnell gave many years ago in which he played some tape by poets like William Carlos Williams and Sylvia Plath. And he made the point that in both cases, these were poets who read up in the upper part of their chest. And he was for saying that if you really are going to find your voice as a poet, you've got to be from deep in your chest. And if you've ever heard Williams speak or Plath speak, their voices are kind of high and tinny. And Galway Kinnell, of course, has this very beautiful baritone. And one of the things I think you might note in that reading by Hassan is he's much more comfortable reading in Arabic, isn't he? Mm-hmm. It sounds like he's reading from the depth of his soul. Reading in English, which is his second or his third language, he's more nervous, and that's what we start to hear. And so I was thinking as I was thinking about this this show today that in creative writing classes we're always talking about the writer finding his or her voice, and it occurred to me that what we mean by that is the writer finding a voice or many voices that seems to resonate at the deepest part of who they are, and that comes about by a process of reading and apprenticeship and writing and failure and experimentation and hoping one way or another to get deeper down inside into your chest, kind of like a chest cold, I guess.
Yeah. Has it been your experience as you've worked with other writers who come here with the International Writing Program that they're... they really want to go back to their own language. They want to read their works in their own language because that's where they live in their own heads.
Well, that is the case, although the minute you said that, I started thinking of one of our most famous poets was the Slovenian poet Tomas Šalamon, who said to me long ago when we were translating his poems that he felt that because he worked in such a small language group, maybe 2 million speakers, that he didn't think his poems began to breathe until they were in English. And we've often had the experience of writers coming here and wanting to write in what they view as a world language if they're coming from smaller languages. Almost always, I think, the experience is not a good one because, generally speaking, writing in your mother tongue is more likely to produce better results. So that's one of the things that they go through.
Yeah. What do you hear when you go to a reading? Maybe you know somebody's work, you know, in advance of a reading, but then you go to hear the author. Do you often have kind of a realization that you've learned something new?
Well, hearing a writer read their work aloud is one of the most interesting parts of reading a work because you can begin to hear how the writer voices the poem. So I'm thinking about poetry in particular, what the rhythms are, what the cadences are, whether they can actually hear the line breaks that they've written, whether they are in control of the vowels and the consonants that they're working with. You can figure out whether a poet really knows what they're doing, whether whether they have tuned their ear very well or not. I also love once hearing Philip Levine say that he only reads new works at readings because he wants to figure out who he has stolen from in the act of writing the poems. And so when you see those moments where someone's reading something new and you see them begin to stumble or hesitate, it's not so much that they've stolen at that moment, but they think, oh my gosh! And you know, and I remember once in I wrote a piece said in Sarajevo, and I remember reading it aloud. And it's a scene with two other friends on a street in Sarajevo where a sniper was shooting at us. And I know that I quoted the man very clearly, who just before the shooting started, he said something is not right. And then many years later, I was reading the Madeline books to my daughter, and you know, Madeline's always saying something is not right. And I thought, gee, I wonder if I, you know, did I take it from Madeline? So every time I've read that section aloud, and you know, I'm thinking, someone's gonna get it.
Well, as we were setting up our discussion for tonight, you also mentioned a reading that is actually accessible on the Virtual Writing University website with Joseph Brodsky, and you said it sounds almost like he's singing.
Well, yeah, I was thinking, especially given what John was talking about in the previous segment about tape as a way of preserving that which is gone, and when we began to, when Jim Elmborg in the library school started to digitize the thousands of hours of tape that we have in the International Writing Program, live from Prairie Lights, and the Writers' Workshop, partly as a custodial effort just to make sure we didn't lose these tapes, which were on reel-to-reel tapes and cassette tapes. The first one he sent me was by my former teacher, Joseph Brodsky, who'd been dead for 10 years at that time, and I put it on. There was an introduction by Marvin Bell, did the translations read by Danny Weisbord, and then to hear Brodsky, this incredible Russian poet, reading in what sounded like the Gregorian chant. He was singing those poems, I thought, and it was just right in my ear. I thought, oh my God, he's here.
Yeah. Well, that might lead us very naturally into a discussion with you, Ed, about Walt Whitman. And you've studied Whitman's work all your life. You have written incredibly important works about Whitman. And then some years ago, a recording of Whitman reading his poem America emerged. Should we hear it first and then have you talk? Would you like to introduce it in any way?
Yeah, let's listen to it. It's pretty remarkable that we have this recording at all. It's the earliest recording by an American poet, and was done in the very late 1880s of Whitman reading most of a short poem of his that he wrote right around that time called America, and it was recorded on a wax cylinder. And as you may know, at the wax cylinder technology at that time meant that when you recorded onto a wax cylinder, you were recording a one-of-a-kind object. There was no sense that Whitman had that he was preserving his voice for posterity. That was more like he was giving a souvenir to someone who would walk off with it and have the souvenir himself. Thomas Edison had wanted to get a recording of Whitman's voice and had told his assistant that he should go down to Camden, which at the time was Camden, New Jersey, where Whitman was living, was the center of the emerging recording industry in America. It's where RCA Victor started and so on, and Menlo Park, where Edison was just up the road. So his assistant named Lippincott went down with a wax cylinder recording machine, stood in line outside of Whitman's house, where people always stood in line waiting for autographs, and went in and instead of an autograph asked Whitman to lean his head into the bell, and this is what Whitman said.
America, center of equal daughters, equal sons, all alike and good, grow, ungrow, young or old, strong, ample, fair, enduring, capable, rich, perennial with the earth, with freedom, law, and love.
So what does that make you imagine about this guy that you knew from his words?
Well, it solved a number of problems when I first heard this in the early 1990s. One is that I had heard from senior Whitman scholars for 20 years or so that they thought there had been a recording of Whitman's voice, and they all vaguely remembered hearing it on a radio program in the early 1950s, but nobody could get any more specific than that. I had done some work with the Museum of Television and Radio in New York City, but nobody could track this down. There was no record of the broadcast. But it turns out that Leon Pearson, who was the brother of Drew Pearson, a famous journalist in the Second World War era and into the 1950s, Leon Pearson for NBC Radio had a sort of proto 60 Minutes type magazine show where he did something very different each week. And one week he did a program called Voices of the Poet. And for this program, he said, we're going to start with the earliest recording of an American poet, a wax cylinder recording. And when this was brought into our studios from the collection of Roscoe Haley, he said, it was unplayable. We couldn't get any, our NBC engineers couldn't get any sound out of it at all, but they worked with it and eventually got the following 30 seconds, and that's what you just heard. That program miraculously did not just vanish into the air, as so many radio programs did in that era, but someone recorded it on an acetate disc recording, and somehow that acetate disc recording found its way into sound archives at Syracuse University, where someone then running an educational cassette tape company in California found it and put it out as an educational tape and sold it to junior high libraries around the country. And it was brought to my attention by a young scholar in Texas who was teaching at a community college in Texas. And he was interested in the problem of Whitman's voice. And the problem of Whitman's voice is that in biographies of Whitman, if you go back in biographies, Whitman's voice always gets described as high-pitched and unpleasant. And that's based on a description by one person who knew Whitman and described his voice as high-pitched and unpleasant. An early biographer picked that description up and said, this is clearly why Whitman never became the orator that he wanted to be. He had a high-pitched and unpleasant voice, and therefore he became a poet and never really liked reading his poems out loud. He became a poet of the printed word rather than the spoken word. Well, the interesting thing is if you go back and read what all of Whitman's other friends said about his voice, they all describe it as a beautiful voice, a rich baritone. He would sing opera. He would declaim Shakespeare from the tops of the omnibuses on Broadway. And as I was talking to this guy in Texas, he said, well, of course, you know, we can decide for ourselves because we've got that recording. And I said, what recording's that? Do you have that recording? And he said, oh, yeah, we have it in our community college library. It's a cassette tape. So this 20-some-year odyssey I had been on ended with a little cassette tape in the community college library in Texas. He copied it, sent it to me, and we had engineers work on the tape, and then we course had it digitized. It's now on the Walt Whitman Archive online, so anyone in the world can hear it now. And many of you, if this sounded vaguely familiar, may have heard it recently in a Levi's ad where Levi's plays that recording to a sort of edgy independent filmmaker's dark vision of of America with neon lights saying America sinking into the sea. And but vibrant, alive, young, rough Americans wearing their Levi's and remaking the spirit of America while Whitman's reading that amazing lines about center of equal daughters, equal sons behind the ad. So what had started as a little souvenir, a one-of-a-kind souvenir, and then went through God knows what kinds of travels to find its way into Roscoe Haley's collection. Roscoe Haley was an elevator operator in the Empire State Building, mm-hmm. lived in Greenwich Village in a little walk-up, was an audiophile, collected wax cylinders, recordings. When he died, his apartment was stuffed full of this stuff, and they basically auctioned it off, and no one knows what happened to the wax cylinder recording. Presumably, it's still out there. There's a kind of, those of you who read Thomas Pynchon in The Crying of Lot 49, there's this shadowy organization called Tristero that is sort of there and not there, but you can be paranoid about it being there. That's exactly how wax cylinder collectors are. They're all over the place. You just don't know them, but they're always there. And there are thousands, tens of thousands of wax cylinders that are continually on the trading market. And so it wouldn't surprise me if the actual wax cylinder someday does show up again. But in the meantime, because of the power of remediation of those technological things like tapes that do become junk unless you can figure out, as Chris and the International Writing Program have done, to get all those things that were quickly becoming garbage remediated, put into a new medium that we can all access and find. It's astounding now, and I've always wondered what Whitman would think if he knew that people around the world were now listening to him in that sort of off-the-cuff moment when he was reading that little poem of America into the bell of the Edison machine.
Yeah, that was actually what I was just going to ask you. What do you think he would think, knowing that he can be heard, 100-some years later?
Well, you've got to imagine, with Whitman, he'd love it. You know, how could he not? You know, when I first had this, got this recording, I was playing it for everybody I could talk into sitting down and listening to it, and a couple of people, I remember Bob Creeley, the poet Robert Creeley, was here, and I told him about the recording, and he wanted to hear it immediately, and he and Helen Vendler, the American poetry critic who was here that same year, both of them, upon hearing it, broke into tears, just began crying. And Creeley, I remember Creeley saying, if you're wondering whether that's authentic, my tears tell you it is.
Mm-hmm. So that's Ed Folsom, those of you listening. And before that, you heard Chris Merrill. And we're going to go now to Garrett Stewart. Hi, Garrett. Great to have you here.
Great to be here. I can't top that saga of remediation, though. I did have one of my own, though, but it's nothing compared to how that cylinder came to us today. But I did have a little trouble getting my two clips of the nasal sonority of John le Carré reading his own work to you. I, too, was struck by the article by Kembrew and John in the Press Citizen about the loss of these memory traces through the lack of access to older media. When I found on eBay these tapes I'd heard of Le Carré reading his own work, they've been eclipsed by CDs of other expert readers since, but the only apparatus I had to play them on that I could lay my hands on was this. My firstborn's first tech toy from 17 years ago. It's hard to find a tape recorder on campus at all anymore. And without it, there would have been nothing here, since it was never remastered. But what I wanted to show you in two clips is what the voice of a reader, and I guess you'd call it a kind of audiobook form, can bring out from his own prose in ways that would surprise even an avid reader of it. I suppose my interest in the author reading his own fiction goes back to the fact that I'm by trade and training a Dickensian, and Dickens was the first great author to make a splash at the lectern reading his own work before there were books on cylinder, books on phonograph, books on tape. Carré is a master at this and does, in fact, shift into chest voice in some of his transitions. The first clip I want to play, they're both from his masterpiece, his autobiographical, semi-autobiographical novel, A Perfect Spy, from 1986, which Philip Roth thought, at least at that point, was the greatest post-war novel in English. What you'll hear is the spy Magnus Pym, a spy for Britain and a double agent for the Soviet Czechs, discovered by the British, hole up in a rooming house that he thinks is secret but is actually under surveillance, emptying out his wallet, the sort of material remains of his life, including his way out, his ticket to Vienna the night before, where he could have crossed over into Czechoslovakia but decided not to. He's stayed behind instead to empty himself out onto paper in writing the epistolary narratives that will become the 550-page novel we've just begun. And as he sits down to do this, what I want you to listen for is the way Le Carré's reading shifts across his own prose, which he's reading straight from the novel at this point, from third Pym speaking about himself and being spoken of in third person, through a kind of spectral indirect discourse into internal monologue, as Le Carré's voice drops in register, becomes more intimate kind of personal in that transition. At that moment, though, there's a very strange thing that I discovered only when transferring, with Jeff Porter's help, transferring this to a CD for transfer to our venue tonight. Carré, at the podium, I suppose, ad-libs a change in his text, which speaks volumes about the new medium he knew he was reading in. The text says, there was a bump, and Pym sat down to his page and began to write. Carré turns that, in his reading aloud, into a question, as if we're in the same audio space with him asking about a sound we've just heard, the bump, and then he gives the explanation. So let's hear the first excerpt.
Put the wallet aside, and continuing his inventory, drew from the same pocket one green airport boarding card, still valid for last night's British Airways flight to Vienna. The sight and touch of it intrigued him. This was when Pym voted with his feet, he thought. In all his life till now, the first completely selfish gesture he had made, with the notable exception of the room where he now sat. The first time he had said, I want, rather than I ought. With a bump, Pym sat down at the desk, set a pile of clean manuscript paper before him, unruled, and took up his pen. To tell it straight, word for word the truth, no evasions, no fictions, no devices, just my over-promised self set free. Some people you see, Tom, dear old son, they leave their bodies to a teaching hospital. Your father, however, has only his secrets. They are his provenance and his curse. To tell it to no one in particular and to everyone. To tell it to all of you who own me, to whom I have given myself with such unthinking liberality, to my handlers and paymasters, to Mary and all the other Marys, to anyone who had a piece in me, was promised more and duly disappointed, and to whatever of myself remained after the great Pym shareout.
I think we can stop there for time, because I want to get in the clip at the other end of the novel, when the text is written, his epistolary novel, all that remains is the last paragraph of our own novel. There's a brilliant thing in his suicide moment when he knows it's over that Carré drops from his recorded reading of this. To my regret, Pym is looking in the mirror like Madame Bovary at the moment of her own death by poison, with towels wrapped around his head in the bathroom to spare the landlady the fuss. And he takes out his gun and he notices of his own image that the face seemed to be leaning into rather than away from the gun, as if it were straining for a sound. Then there's a gap between paragraphs, a white blank in the text, a space between words that is tacitly filled in. And Le Carré picks up in the reading you'll hear, as the text does, with the line, Mary, his wife, Mary never heard the shot. And that's the way I read it to myself, read it aloud even once to a friend. But Le Carré puts the emphasis on never heard the shot, much less melodramatic, much less exaggerating the lacuna of the death moment, much more as if she inferred it from the subsequent action, which involves, most immediately, the man in the surveillance car next to her jumping out and running to the scene of the suicide, her former lover and her husband's handler, Brotherhood, who is then figured as a vestige of empire, first Roman, now implicitly British, frozen solid at the end of the line. There's some nice joking irony about the troops rushing to the spot, whatever that is, and then the brilliant last sentence, which Le Carré has also altered. In the book, it's one of his show-stopping pieces of understatement, the sort of letdown at the end of all of his novels. And everyone was watching a dignified little lady in a dressing gown coming down the steps of her house. After all this soul-scoring self-examination by the brilliant and likable spy, we get this aftermath. But Le Carré tops it when he reads it aloud. He adds two more words to this stair-stepped descent, this falling cadence. He slips in, after dressing gown and shawl, the neo-Dickensian stylist, I think, adding an extra iambic foot into the mix. I'll leave you with this because I can't do better, and listening to it, you get really inside the head of the text, the sensorium as well as the thinking behind it.
And when he'd done that, he pulled out the gun and loaded it and cocked it, all rather swiftly, and set it on the desk, thinking of the many times he had carried a gun and not fired it. Mary never heard the shot. Suddenly, Brotherhood shoved open the driver's door, sending the superintendent flying to one side. But with the clamor all round him, he was standing still. Lights had come on. Ambulances were racing to the spot without apparently knowing where the spot was. Police and plainclothesmen were falling over each other, and the fools on the roof were shouting at the fools in the square, and England was being saved from things it didn't know were threatening it. But Jack Brotherhood was standing to attention, like a dead centurion at his post, and everyone was watching a dignified little lady in a dressing gown and shawl coming down the steps of her house.
Well, thank you, Garrett Stewart, Ed Folsom, and Chris Merrill. Thank you so much. So, as you know, this is World Canvass, and I'll invite our guests up for the next segment, Lisa Weaver and Jeff Porter, if you'd like to come up and join us. International Programs New World Reach Initiative showcases UI faculty, students, guests, artists, and speakers involved in international teaching and learning for local, national, and international audiences. And World Reach also supports many live events in our area, including educational programming for students and teachers. More information at accents.international.uiowa.edu. Well, now we are going to turn to the tape recorder and, by expansion, today's digital devices in the social, political, and historical context. And I've asked Chris Merrill to stay here with us because, in addition to being a poet and a writer, he has been a journalist covering the war in Yugoslavia. He's recently been to Iran, where there are so many interesting things being reported through social media and otherwise. That I thought Chris could add a lot to this discussion. And Lisa Weaver is with us as well. Nice to have you here, Lisa. Thank you. Lisa has been a journalist for many, many years, and she is teaching now in the School of Journalism and Mass Communication here at the University of Iowa. She's teaching students to be reporters, and I think we'll have a lot of interesting things to add. And Jeff Porter is with us as well. He's from the Department of English. He runs the Media Lab. He is a documentarian, producing all kinds of interesting radio pieces. And we'll talk a little more about what Jeff does when we get to him. But I think I'd like to start first with you, Lisa. Again, welcome. And I wonder if you would tell us a little bit about some of what you have witnessed in the years you spent reporting in China, and what you are aware of now that you need to be telling your students about the changes and the ways we can capture scenes and words and events as they occur on the ground.
Well, I'll focus on one aspect. There have been so many changes in media, from analog to digital, obviously, for both radio, audio, as well as video. But I thought I'd talk a bit about how small and mobile television equipment has become, because that has really changed the way camera crews go out and gather information. It reduces the number of people, often, who gather the information, and it makes people in the field a lot busier in many ways than they used to be. I'll sort of start in 2001 with the Hainan spy plane incident, which you may recall happened on April Fool's Day, ironically. 2001, a Chinese fighter jet collided with a U.S. surveillance craft in the South China Sea. The aircraft made an emergency landing, unfortunately, on a military airstrip in China. Fortunately, because they survived, and they were able to get the airplane down in one piece, barely, but unfortunately because they landed in China without an invitation. And then following that, the Chinese authorities held, I think it was 11 or 12 American aircrew members for about 10 days of this sort of tense standoff between Washington and Beijing, Beijing demanding an apology, Washington sort of holding back, and then finally coming forth with an apology and the people being released. The reason that the story was significant in broadcast terms was that CNN was able to use something called a video phone. Since then, you've all seen a lot of coverage using the video phone. It's when you have the kind of the grainy, jittery footage of a live shot, a correspondent speaking live, or some image. And the video phone had been used before the Hainan spy plane incident to cover, thinking back, a big earthquake in India a couple months before. But that was an international story. It didn't have a really big U.S. interest. So the Hainan spy plane incident was the first time the video phone was used on a big U.S. story. It was significant because while, to back up a bit and say that China is a country, not the only one, but the one most people think of, that controls video images leaving the country. And they do that by intercepting the satellite footage that you're sending out. So usually the satellite footage has to go to a ground monitor, a ground station, and if they don't like what they see, they pull the plug. That's it. You have no live feed. A video phone allows, it's about the size of a box, a briefcase, pretty easy to use. It's really a telephone with a video image. The image goes straight from the phone up to the satellite. There's no way to intercept it. Now, the authorities allowed us to broadcast for a good week without raising any objections, really without saying anything one way or the other. I believe because we were within the confines of a hotel on a balcony reporting this is what the U.S. negotiator is saying about the standoff, this now is what the Chinese negotiator is saying, so sort of equal coverage, China getting its voice out, so they looked the other way. But when the crew was released, we left the hotel. We had a pretty good idea. CNN had a pretty good idea that they were going to be released. And a plane was sent from Guam, the U.S. Protectorate of Guam, to Hainan Island, which is in southern China. We were out in literally a rice paddy with cows wandering by with ringing bells before dawn, waiting for this plane to land. We ended up broadcasting that live, and it was actually very boring minute to minute. The plane landed, it sat on the runway, it took forever. The bus emerged with the Americans, they eventually got on the plane, and then the plane took off. We were not live with that all the time. That was interspersed with a lot of talk and analysis from Washington, New York, Beijing, Hong Kong, etc. But it led to an on-air arrest, which at the time seemed very dramatic. We were live. We had just got the shot of the plane with the Americans on it flying off into the fog. It was a foggy day. So the plane's gone, out of sight, and then before long, the cops close in, and they don't know really quite what we're doing, but eventually asked us to close down our operation, all of which was done on camera, on live television. Then I proceeded to continue to report live on a telephone from the back of the police car that was taking us and some other journalists who did not have a video phone to the police station to be detained and questioned, just sort of the normal routine. Now, CNN did a huge job of patting itself on the back for getting the video, for having the video phone, ABC News had one, couldn't get theirs to work. So it was just sort of luck of the draw. Huge PR job on CNN's part. The Chinese authorities confiscated the phone, detained us for hours. Nothing happened to us. Confiscated our press passes, took the video phone. We had to go back to Beijing. The video phone was returned, you know, in a month or so. And I remember my biggest worry, however, being for our assistant, who was a Chinese national. She really could have been in trouble, but in the end, she wasn't. So the authorities had to get their head around what this technology was. They declared it illegal because it was this sort of, you know, it was the first illegal broadcast, actually, out of China. A few months later, the war in Afghanistan began, and all the news organizations bought video phones. It became that one story, the Hainan spy plane incident, probably had a bigger effect, more than anything, on the purchase of the video phone. The company's stock must have just gone through the roof. Everybody had one. And so it's real, this is my point, its real use now is reporting from remote locations like Afghanistan, Iraq, during the invasion and the embedding process. Ironically, China, which you know initially didn't know what it was and then you know sort of declared it illegal by definition, now has video phones also. Chinese journalists use them, foreign journalists sort of quietly get them into the country and sort of put them in a closet. But it's recognized that this is a way that journalists operate. In terms of getting video out from any country that seeks to control satellite images, video compression is actually probably a bigger challenge because you just can't really intercept it at all. It's not real-time live, but you can use ISDN lines to, you know, compress the video, send it, and then on the other end, making it really a lot easier in as much as you have the footage in the first place to then get it out of a country and on the air. In Iraq, during the embedding of Iraq, the invasion, the video phone was one of many things that made televising a war live possible. Major broadcasters were, I will say, really looking forward to the ratings. I know that sounds really, you know, cynical to put it that way, but that's what it came down to. Everybody knew the war was going to start. It was only a matter of when. The networks, including CNN, big, large television operations, were spending lots of money waiting in Kuwait, waiting for it to start, for the war to start, so that their embedded journalists, and I was one of them, one of, you know, 600 at least, could follow troops into the field and actually cover a war live. What comes to mind, I show this to students sometimes because it's both technically really interesting but in a way disturbing, is a CNN correspondent who went in with the full accompaniment of sort of a guard and a technician and his own Humvee and big satellite dish, showing images of tanks racing toward Baghdad, which you may remember seeing. I mean, he probably wasn't the only reporter to use those images. But I think his words were something like, racing walls of steel, ever pushing northward, ever pushing, pushing toward Baghdad. I mean, it was a little bit, you know, technologically amazing, but at the same time, and I'm veering off a little bit into, I think, the politics of what embedding meant for the Pentagon, served another purpose, which in a way was to allow the United States to demonstrate to the region, to Iraq, to the leadership of Iraq and the region at large, that it was there. So embedding made possible with the incredible technology available, I think was great for media access, but there was also another side to that. There was a reason the Pentagon said yes. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just to be nice to journalists. It was also because, well, maybe, you know, we can use this too. This is an information war as much as you know, a conventional one. And, you know, video phones continue to be used in the Haiti coverage, in remote areas, disaster zones, that normally would be really difficult to get people and equipment into. So it's quite amazing.
Yeah. Oh, thank you, Lisa. That's so interesting. And I want to tie that in now to some of the experiences Chris had when you were covering the war in Yugoslavia. That's a few years before. No video phone in your hands, I suppose.
No.
Tell us a little bit about what you saw and what you were doing there.
Yeah. The interesting thing to hear Lisa talk about this is that it only this would have been 6, 7, 8 years before in Yugoslavia you could get satellite phones. I remember they were $45 a minute. But you didn't have any video, and you really didn't have very much access to the news going on in various parts of the country. In Sarajevo, which I was covering, there was which was under siege, the longest siege in modern history. There was for a long time no gas, water, or electricity. So all of these things that we take for granted, which would have a video phone would have been useful for, just didn't figure into it. But I was thinking, as I was talking to Joan earlier, I remember interviewing a man who, toward the end of the war, the Bosnian government dug a tunnel under the airport in Sarajevo, and they ran a huge power line through this tunnel. And this was how stuff started getting smuggled in, everything from food to booze to guns, and eventually television dishes, satellite dishes. So you could, toward the end of the war, you could actually come home at night after, you know, wandering around with soldiers and watch TV. And I remember once coming home and watching with a humanitarian a show called Real Personal on, I think it was the early days of MSNBC. It was an interview show about sex. I thought this is kind of funny here in the middle of a siege. But this guy I interviewed one day said, when there was still no phone service in the city, he came home from something and he turned on the TV and CNN had a team in there, and he saw his daughter shot on TV, and in the leg, and she ended up being fine. But this was the first that he knew about it. It had happened many hours earlier in the day, and he looked at her and he said, "My God, that's my daughter." And of course he raced to the hospital, and she ended up being okay. But I thought, in that little image, there was no way to get him the information ahead of before then. It had happened however many hours before, but all the conventional means of communication were down. And here, because of the because of a satellite dish, he was able to watch his life fall apart, and that seemed to me to be emblematic of the new world we were heading into. So I think of that war as the last war in the information wars that go on during conflict. That was that's almost like a pre-technological kind of experience, because now it's a much different ballgame.
And you were recently in Iran for some various visits, and I think we're all aware that there is so much coming out every day,
yeah,
through blog sites, people tweeting when things happen, the image of the young woman killed has become sort of a symbol now. This is happening almost instantly.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's interesting. When I was there, this was in late September, early October, I talked to one man who said that Nokia had, at the request of the Iranian government, had inserted a chip into its mobile phones that would allow the government to track down who was sending out footage to BBC and CNN. And
right,
that's how they were arresting people. And then, so this is the beauty, the invisible hand of the market. People stopped buying Nokia phones. And then Nokia removed the chip, and now they were using those phones again. And that's the imagery that we've been watching come out of there ever since the disputed elections back in June.
Mm-hmm. Well, so one question that I think comes to many of us is how can you tell anything you see on the internet, even the most moving things? How can you tell whether it's real? How does a journalist judge whether or not reports that are coming from various places through these internet sites should be believed? Do you still have to be there on the ground and see it yourself?
Well, sometimes, I mean, ideally, yes, but in instances like Iran, during the election dispute, foreign journalists were kicked out. Those that were there were having a very difficult time reporting. Media organizations, from what I can tell, verify as best they can, and they say, okay, we can't verify this exactly, unconfirmed. But they're using those images like Netta.
Mm-hmm.
and others that I really find fascinating for a lot of stories, but there's something about the Iranian story that I suspect media scholars, I suspect that this is really going to be a watershed in the use of social media and both the political opposition and then, as you just mentioned, also the leadership of that country trying to use things like Nokia and Facebook to trace
where things are going.
Dissidents who are abroad, Iranians living abroad who are protesting, but I'm sort of wandering from my point. I think what journalists do is simply verify as best they can, and what it comes down to is when there is no other way to get the images. Protests in Myanmar, former Burma, about 2 or 3 years ago, comes to mind also because that was a case in which really the only video getting out was coming from activists inside the country and then smuggled across the border into Thailand and then, you know, disseminated that way. The Virginia Tech killings, not nearly as controversial in terms of trying to verify the source of the video, but that was a story reported largely based on Facebook. The students at Student Tech had the information before the New York Times did.
Yeah.
So the short answer is, if there are other ways to get the story, I suppose journalists don't use the unverifiable, but if that's all there is, they say that's all there is, and they use it because it's better to have some sort of image than nothing at all.
Yeah. Let's just change our focus for one moment to a little clip we have that I'd like to ask you to describe, Chris. When you were writing one of your recent books, I'll ask you to talk about it. You went to Mount Athos. And tell us about Mount Athos. Not everyone has access to this place, and for, I suppose, centuries, what happened in Mount Athos stayed in Mount Athos, but not so much now.
Well, Mount Athos is a protectorate of Greece. It's in the northern part of the country, and for about 11 or 1200 years, it has been a monastic state. There are 20 monasteries there. There are probably about 3,000 monks. Women haven't been allowed on the peninsula of the Holy Mountain since about 1100. An edict was issued that against having women there because they had been some of the flock shepherdesses were performing services for the monks that went beyond making cheese and milk and bread. So actually, as it happens, even female animals are banned from this place, except for cats. So it's been a pretty mysterious place for a long time, and I ended up traveling there on a number of occasions and writing a book about it. And part of what was interesting to me was to write about a place that people had not could only visit under rather difficult conditions. If you were not Orthodox, only 10 permits were offered a day, and the living conditions are pretty tough. The monks have been living very ascetic lives for a very long time, and when I first started going there was very little video or sound coming out of any part of the Holy Mountain, so I was interested to see what that was about. And in the last few years now, there are videos out there, and pilgrims go with their cell phones, so they are recording the monks chanting and getting video of the icons in these formerly inaccessible monasteries.
And we have a little cut from the monks of Simona Petra.
Simona Petra is a beautiful monastery perched on top of a cliff about 800 feet above the sea.
Okay.
So these cassette tapes have been distributed among people who've gone to the Holy Mountain in the same way that before the Iranian Revolution, the sermons of Khomeini were recorded in Paris and then distributed throughout the country.
Well, so Jeff Porter, let's go to you and talk a little bit about the work you do. You create audio pieces, you create documentaries, you have used tape and found sound and so on and so forth, and you brought a couple of clips of work that other people have done. Tell us a little bit about what the tape recorder has done to the areas you study and work in.
Well, it's cured me of YouTube, I think, for one thing, as I've become an old fart in developing this sort of pure bond with audio. I'm an unreformed tapehead, and I think that's partly owing to my parents, who, when I was a kid, used to tape themselves down in the basement. This is the same time when Nixon was taping himself. They would simulate a radio broadcast. My mother would sing Perry Como songs, karaoke style, and my uncle would bring his giant German reel-to-reel tape recorder. And they were quite serious about it. My father's a musician, so he had instruments around, and he would sometimes play with the large RCA stereo player. And then my father would take turns then impersonating Edward R. Murrow, when he would say, "This is Buffalo." And I, you know, they created such a racket, and I was just trying to read, and I would come downstairs and hush them up. It was such an ironic thing. You know, I was supposed to be listening to the Rolling Stone and making noise myself, but my parents were doing this. And I hated them for it, but I somehow, I internalized this somehow, and I'm in love now with tape recorders. And even though we have all these little digital devices around, late at night I will surf eBay for old German tape recorders. They're just wonderful objects. I've got a couple of scenarios to talk about real quickly, and it has to do with recording documentary subjects on tape recorders and digital tape, and what it's sort of done to my imagination over the past few years. The first scenario is kind of earnest, and I apologize for that, but the second scenario is a little funnier and kind of ironic. And so the first one has to do with non-celebrity voices, documentary subjects. I've taped a lot of people, both in film and for sound-only programs, and I'm always really amazed at how irresistible the voice sounds when listening through headphones to their recordings. And the funny thing is, this never happens in the interview itself. The interviews usually are kind of depressing and unforgettable. But as soon as the interviewee leaves the premises, I run to the tape recorder, put my headphones on, rewind, and listen, and that's really where the fascination takes hold. And it's really curious. It's never happened making a film. You know, when you go back to the studio after shooting, and it's, you know, it's so much more painful, you know, to strike, set, return back, and then get your tape in the machine and see what you've got. The first thing you do is make sure you've focused on the subject's face. You want to make sure the lighting's right, the framing. And so you're looking visually and you're listening to your subject, but the sound of your subject's voice now is really like an adjective. It's purely describing something else. It's part of the scene and the context. And I think when we're making films, especially documentary films, we're always trying to define that documentary subject as some kind of social or cultural agent. And everything is a sign that helps us describe that agent. And so the voice is really just a means towards that end. But in radio or sound only, that voice is kind of liberated from that kind of construction. And it's amazing what happens. I think that, you know, there's something strange about the voice. And I've researching radio's past, you can sense to what extent that programmers and the networks were always a little bit afraid of the power of the voice, the pure sound of the voice. When you listen on a tape recorder to someone you've recorded, you can begin to hear all the things that can't be somehow contained by the words. I mean, the sound of the voice clearly exceeds the sense of the speech. And that, to me, is what is so fascinating. And what to do with that, it's really hard to say. It's a kind of a strangeness. And you really can't, I think, put words on it. And we don't really have codes. It's a bit like trying to figure out exactly what's cool about an opera. You know, when you go well past the silliness of the text, There's something strange, but you really can't describe it. So, I mean, there is something, it's like the pure signifiers of music. There's something that you really can't put your finger on, but it's part of the experience. And when I work with the voice, I'm always trying to figure out ways to intuit that strangeness and do something with it. And so what I'd like to play for you is a clip from...
I think that's Volkan. Actually, you know what that is? That's Volkan, our next performer, is a double bassist,
really?
And he's tuning up somewhere. So we'll go ahead and listen to your clip.
Good.
It will be accompanied by double bass.
This is, I was working on a, actually, the I was working on a little project about IWP writers from all over the world who went to a Fort Madison rodeo a couple of years ago, and I've never understood why the IWP does that to foreigners who just newly arrived in Iowa City. They immediately send them to Fort Madison, which is so scary. I've never been to a rodeo in my life, and I was freaked out really, really badly. And so,
part of the design.
They come back to Iowa City and they never leave. They never ask. So I was putting together a documentary piece on their sort of take on a rodeo, because their understanding of America is far different from what happens when they're in the small corners and pockets of rural America. And here's the voice of a journalist and a translator from Kyrgyzstan. Could you play clip number 4, Mike?
You see, our cowboys, we don't tell them, because cowboy, we have this word in Russian, as it is, cowboy, we say, right? And it immediately refers to America and to these Marlboro guys, you know, smoking the cigarette, this cowboy hat and stuff, and to Jean as well, to Jean, yeah. But, of course, we have them. We don't name them as that, but they are real cowboys in the sense that from the 4 o'clock in the morning, when they have to get up to feed the horses, to look afterwards, and actually their life is hard. You know.
Thanks, Mike. I don't know if you kind of hear that. I mean, this is Jambi from Kyrgyzstan, and she's a really, really lively interview. And what I heard through the headphones, without seeing her face, when listening again and again to her voice, was a kind of a critical intelligence that sort of really, and a playfulness, and I hate to overuse the word irony, there is a certain kind of an irony there that I could never really put words to. And it seemed to me that she was finding that right space between America and Kyrgyzstan in which to kind of be critical and yet somehow kind of generously understanding of differences. And it was really, really, it was kind of marvelous. And I mean, it was, everything she said was just very, very straightforward. We'd have cowboys too. Our cowboys are a little bit different. And so she went on in a sort of ethnographic way describing Western traditions in Kyrgyzstan. But that critical intelligence sort of rises above all of that. And that's where I think the real communication was. And of course, that was something I wanted to put into play when I was working with the piece. And there were many others. There were folks from Libya, Palestine, from New Zealand, from Denmark and Germany. And they were all doing equally different sorts of things with this sort of vocal excess in positioning themselves next to America. What was interesting was the New Zealander was the most literally critical and ironic about his interpretation of the rodeo event. He was so shocked by the rodeo event. I have another voice, and this is a different project, and it's an American voice, but I think also you can hear in this exquisite nasal sound so much excess meaning. This is Michael Silverblatt from The Bookworm. Number 2.
I used to go to the beauty parlor with my mom, and I didn't like it, but it was, you know, I grew up with my mom, my dad, and my grandma in the same house, and my mother wouldn't want to leave me behind to get in my grandmother's hair, so I'd go with her, and that's a long, boring process for a child. And next to it was a store called Our Baby Store, which had a lot of things from older than babies.
We can pause there. Thanks, and Mike. Are you familiar? Do you remember Michael Silverblatt from Bookworm? I mean, the guy's been on the air in Los Angeles, I think, for years, doing his show, his weekly book review show, and I think people, and he's got a cult following. He was here not long ago, and he actually did a live interview of John McPhee on stage at the Engel Theater, and it was really a lot of fun. I don't think people tune in to hear the interview per se. I think they tune in to listen to Michael Silverblatt's voice. And I can't tell you, I mean, again, I can't simply with words describe what's going on in his voice, but it's something really wonderful and scary at the same time. And I think, you know, this is, we can't be without such a voice. It's just a remarkable voice. Lastly, there's, this is a different kind of a scenario. This is sort of the funny one. This is a lot closer to Ed's description of the mystery of Whitman's voice and its circulation. This is a celebrity voice, and it's part of, you know, the weird phenomenon of the tape recorder, that it can isolate the voice from the body. And if I remember right, when Edison first began dabbling in recording technology, his intent was to record the voice, capture the voice of the dead. And so, I mean, that sort of ghostliness that is even alive today in digital recording with those paranormal people who are chasing electronic voice phenomena is really part of this long arc of the tape recorder. The voice stays alive. Orson Welles has long been dead, but he was, in the early 70s, he was making a bad TV ad for, I think, for frozen peas in London. And he was notoriously difficult to work with. And it seems that the sound engineer did a stealth recording of the entire session. And it's become notorious. And it's been circulating since the early 70s in the underground of the tape, underground world of the tape recorder. And it's been re-recorded, first by sound engineer. They'd pass the tape. One guy would pass the tape to the next guy. He would dub it, and then he would pass it to the next guy, and he would dub it. And so it's been around, not online. It's online now, but it's gone through so many generations, it's really a mess. Somehow, this subversive media prankster group called Negative Land in the late 80s, or in the 90s, got a hold of a pretty good recording of Orson Welles' rant when doing the ad, and they remixed it. They remixed it with an outtake, an unauthorized outtake from the top 40 DJ Casey Kasem, who was throwing a temper tantrum when spinning up U2. This is the U2 incident. I'm forgetting in '91, which made Negative Land famous. They did a parody of the U2 song that was mixed with the Casey Kasem, and they suffered a huge lawsuit by Island Record. And this suddenly, you know, this propelled them into national fame, and as a result, they became this really important subversive media prankster group. And they do sound collages. They got their hands on the Welles piece, and they mix it together with some copy from advertising theory books on how to sell something. It was sort of media theory, but for ad makers on how to sell something. And this is what it sounded like. It's called
okay.
Jolly Green Giant.
You ready? Going on three.
One rider might do it this way. The pea is planned that ends vegetable wars forever. The green giant, who is just about as big as a corn and pea man can get, has a plan that guarantees peas on earth forever.
Okay, this is 11, second half.
Peas on earth forever. Peas on earth, goodwill towards man. According to his plan,
we can pause
you
there,
just
though,
reached
Mike.
For a cannon.
Yeah, yeah. That, trust me, it's funny.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, if anybody wants to hear the whole thing, we'll send it to you through email. It's amazing. But go ahead, Jeff, and
it's online. You can find it. I'll just say that because it's now been recycling Ad infinitum on the internet. It's been used in dance remixes. It's appeared in all kinds of other sort of sound collages. It's now become, in a way, it's become kind of a tape trope online, this sort of the ghostly voice of Orson Welles.
Yes. Yeah. So that was Negative Land, and it was the Jolly Green Giant Peas piece. So if you want to find it, it's online. I want to say thank you to Jeff Porter, Lisa Weaver, and Chris Merrill. Such an interesting conversation. Thank you so much. Thank you. And now we are going to welcome Volkan Orhon to join us here. He's an amazing double bassist, and we were pleased to hear that you were in the hall just a couple of minutes ago, Volkan. And as Volkan begins to get himself ready here, I'll tell you what we're going to do. Do you prefer to come on over and sit with us for a second? So Volkan Orhon, please welcome him to our stage. So many of you know Volkan. He was born in Turkey. He works now here in the University of Iowa and faculty in the School of Music. He performs Cedar Rapids Symphony, travels all over the world playing, and he has done lots of interesting recording projects on his own, one of which was a project called Multiplicity some years ago. And let's talk about Multiplicity.
Sure. What would you like to know?
Well, I'd like to know, how did you do it? It was multi-layering of your own performance on various tracks.
Well, this whole project started off with a happy hour conversation, and we ended up turning into a project, and it was just between friends, and he was talking about the technology that was out there for musicians, that you could just actually multi-layer yourself playing over, you know, whatever you just played previously. And I thought that was just fascinating, and I said, well, in that case, you could probably play all your bass ensembles all by yourself. And he's like, yeah, you could. And then he was teaching a class. I used to live in Connecticut at that point. Excuse me. And he was going to include this subject in his coursework. And he said, well, would you like to be my guinea pig? And I said, sure. What do you want me to do? So we ended up doing the project with the students and just kind of looking at the difficulties and the disadvantage and advantages of, using the technology.
Yeah. So you played each of the, you transcribed pieces.
I transcribed some of the pieces. Some of the pieces I actually used the existing quartets and things like that. But I transcribed a number of pieces on the CD. What I end up doing, I just never tried this before all by myself, because when you're playing an ensemble, it's helpful to look at each other and engage with one another and play. But when you're playing one line and try to be expressive at the same time, it's just kind of challenging.
Yeah.
So I didn't know where to start. Should I start with the top line, which is the solo line, or should I start from the foundation, the bass line? The first piece that we actually started the project was the Barbara Adagio for strings, which I'm going to perform today. First I started with the bottom, and then by the time I got to the second part, I was totally lost because I had no beat. I was not using any click track or anything like that. So it was just like, you will hear it, it's just like a sustained note, and I tried to meet the beat within that, you know, unknown length. That's going to happen at the same time. But I mean, I used to play with it now. I've performed it a couple of times, so it's a little bit easier.
Yeah. Well, so what you're going to be hearing is everything but the solo line on tape, and then Volkan will play the solo line live for us here. Mm-hmm. This is the Barber Adagio, Samuel Barber's piece, the Adagio for Strings, and
actually,
what else should we say?
Can we do maybe sample, just so they can also hear,
sure,
and I can
sure.
see the, hear the level?
Sure,
we didn't
absolutely.
Get a chance to rehearse this, so this is going to be on the fly.
Yeah.
Thank you. Oh, actually, I will nod for you to start. Is that okay? I'll start and then nod, you press the play button. We'll see how it goes. Meet you at the end.
No. Mike, I think he wants to go ahead and start, and then.
Thank you.
So this is Volkan Orhon, and you know, when Jeff Porter and others were talking about all the things that you can pick up from the voice that you can't pick up from words, for me, it's the same as listening to a beautiful recording and then watching someone like Volkan play, because you see this beautiful image as he's caressing this instrument. It's so beautiful. So thank you for doing this. One of the other things we wanted to quickly chat about was the way, of course, with tapes and all kinds of other devices, music moves across borders. I think music always moved across borders. Mm-hmm. But, you know, what we think of as an American art form, jazz, was something that Volkan, studying in conservatory in Turkey, came to love and played, in fact, with a friend of his, you may know, a very famous classical pianist, Fazıl Say. They are friends and have performed together in a jazz quartet. Yeah. Tell us something about all that.
Well, that was a really intriguing and interesting project. I mean, I don't call myself a jazz bass player, but he used to live in New York at the time when I used to live in Connecticut. He called me one day and just said, well, I have this vision, and I love jazz, I love bass, piano, and I have this idea of putting Turkish traditional flute, it's a reed flute, ney is the original name, including into this quartet, it's jazz quartet. And I said, well, that sounds intriguing and interesting. What do you want to do? And he said, well, let's just take the folk tunes and just kind of work them up a little bit and just put some jazz chords in it and see what happens. And he also composes regularly. He's actually taken off with composition now more than performing. He does that as well. But this particular piece that you're going to play for you, he wrote this, I guess he started singing it in his mind in Central Park, New York, when he was walking his dog, and it's ballad, and it kind of features the bass solo.
Okay. So. Ballad.
Thank you.
I guess we can begin to fade out of it a little bit. It was so nice to hear the bass come in, all the interesting pieces there. So that's Fuzzle's size piece, Ballade.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And
That was a recording of it, live performance in, I believe it was in Montpellier, France.
Yeah.
And we did a tour in Europe and Turkey, and we had about 10 concerts, I believe, something like that. It was a great experience.
Yeah, terrific. Well, before we end our show, I'd like to invite Kembrew and John Peters back up to just, you know, any sort of wrap-up thoughts based on what they've heard tonight or anything related to music. We're almost at the end of our program, and thank you, Volkan. I think there's fine. We're all good. And John, what do you have to say?
Well, I was thinking about the old law of physics that you can't be in many places at one time, but what I've noticed is you can be many times in one place.
Yeah.
with this performance, and that's part of the magic of recording for me.
Yeah. Kembrew.
Yeah, well, the thing that I find interesting about the tape is, just from the perspective of a media scholar, is that okay, there's this huge body of literature, academic literature, and popular literature on the phonograph, and it's the literature on digital media is exploding. But it's really kind of strange that this medium, the tape, that had such a deep, profound impact for really 50 years in culture and politics and the arts, really, we don't think about it as much, but still, it retains these traces. Like back in the day, when hip hop was transmitted primarily through mixtapes, and they called them mixtapes, the term mixtape continues, and it continued into the era of the CD. People, when they give people mix CDs, they often call them mixtapes. And even more strange, mixtapes are these things that you can get online, they're still called tapes, mixtapes.
Right.
And so, you know, even though they're ubiquitous, and even though we don't really seem to think about it much, nevertheless, they have these traces that still exist today.
Yeah. Well, it's so amazing to live in this modern world, because for millennia, humans have been doing pictures. But it's only in the modern world that we've been able to actually store sound.
Yeah.
Technically, you can't store sound, of course, because sound is pressure. I mean, it needs to be renewed every time. But the ability to record it and to preserve it in some way, this is something which is radically modern. Yeah. And even though the visual gets played up a lot more, I think that this is the real interesting break with mm-hmm. the times we live in, that we can listen to Walt Whitman's voice and you can accompany yourself and all these fascinating things.
Yeah. Wow. Well, thank you. This has been just an amazing evening for me. I hope you've enjoyed it as well. John Peters, Kembrew McLeod, Volkan Orhon, all of our other wonderful guests. Thank you, everyone in the audience, for coming. I hope you enjoyed the program. And we thank our friends at UITV for doing all of the recording tonight masterfully, and also our friends at KRUI, who will be rebroadcasting this program. Want to make sure that in addition to keeping an eye out for World Canvass programs, you're aware that a new program from International Programs will be held next Thursday at Prairie Lights Bookstore. It's called Prairie Insight, and it's an opportunity for conversation around international topics, and Gerhard Krop will be the discussion host. So we hope you'll take advantage of that. Also on the 25th, something else that's kind of fun from international programs is the International Happy Hour at Atlas World Cafe. So thank you for coming tonight. I'm Joan Kjaer. This is World Canvass, and the broadcast times for UITV and KRUI will be listed on the International Programs website, which is accents.international.uiowa.edu. I'm Joan Kjaer. Thanks for coming, and good night. And thank you.